going?
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Tikuma Island Online.
Yes, we're ready for another week already.
That's right.
It kind of zips right by.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, the program zips right by, but the week zips right by too as well, so.
And this week, we finally get to the cool story.
We finally get to the climax of Gideon, yes, where he's still not sure about it, but it's one of my favorite stories.
Gideon's really not shown a lot of faith up until this point. So we'll see if he shows a little bit more faith in our story today.
Yeah, and Gideon had a lot of worries.
Yes, he did.
So later on in the program, I've got an object lesson using ping pong balls and water that talks about worry and how we can overcome worry in our lives. So that's pretty cool. I'm looking forward to that.
That sounds like something we could all use about now.
I think so.
We all have a lot of worries in our life.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on right now. So, yeah.
So I guess we should get to our program then.
I think so, yes.
So, okay, we'll see you back at the end.
Catch you then. The Bible tells us in Nehemiah, I think it's chapter 8, verse 10, that the joy of the Lord is my strength. How do you get the joy of the Lord? Well, you get the joy of the Lord by praising God. Thanking God for who He is and for the different things that He does. So when God created the different animals and creatures, they give praise to God. I love going out in the morning, early on. And as I go out in the morning, especially like in the springtime or the summertime, the birds are out. And they're chirping away. And it's just such a calming and a peaceful time. Birds are one animal that will praise God. But there are other ones also. Let's see if I can get this thing done. and get it set. Grab my marker. Give him a couple eyes. And we'll give him a mouth. And we wind up with a frog. If you live near a pond, especially like in the countryside, in the springtime and even throughout the summer, you'll hear the peepers. Little frogs that are just peeping away, making noise, chirping, whatever. And it's their way of praising God. And it happens every single night. And so one of the challenges for you guys is, how much time do you take actually praising God? Thanking Him for who He is and for what He does. We can learn a lesson from frogs, from birds, and things like that, that we should be praising God all the time. Because God is such an amazing and a wonderful God that loves you so much. Will you take time this week to praise God?
Today, I'd like to read to you another one of my fun books about Alexander. And today is Alexander Who's Not, Do You Hear Me? I Mean It, Going to Move. They can't make me pack my baseball bit or my I Love Dinosaurs sweatshirt or my cowboy boots. They can't make me pack my ice skates, my jeans with 8 zippers, my compass, my radio, or my stuffed pig. My dad is packing. My mom is packing. My brothers Nick and Anthony are packing. I'm not packing. I'm not going to move. My dad says we have to move where his new job is. That job is 1,000 miles away. My mom says we have to move to where our new house is. That house is 1,000 miles away. Right next door to the new house, there's a boy who is Anthony's age. Down the street, there's a boy of the same age as Nick. There's no one next door or down the street or maybe for 1,000 miles who is my age. I'm not. Do you hear me? I mean it. I'm not going to move. I'll never have a best friend like Paul again. I'll never have a great sitter like Rachel again. I'll never have my soccer team or my carpool again. I'll never have kids who know me except my brothers, and sometimes they don't want to know me. I'm not packing. I'm not going to move. Nick says I'm a fool and should get a brain transplant. Anthony says I'm being immature. My mom and my dad say that after a while I'll get used to living 1,000 miles from everything. Never. No way. No way. N-O. I maybe could stay here and live with the Baldwins. They've got a dog. I always wanted a dog. I maybe could stay here and live with the Rooneys. They've got 6 girls. They always wanted one boy. I maybe could stay here and live with Mr. and Mrs. Oberdorfer. They always give great treats on Halloween. I maybe could stay here and live by myself in maybe a treehouse or maybe a tent or maybe a cave. Nick says I could live in the zoo with all the other animals. Anthony says I'm being immature. My dad says I should take a last look at all my special places. I'm taking a look, but it won't be my last. I looked at the Rooney's roof, which I once climbed out on, but then I couldn't climb back in until the fire department came and helped me. I looked at Pearson's drugstore, where they once said my mom had to pay them $80 when I threw a ball in the air that I almost caught. I looked at the lot next to Albert's house, where I once and for all learned to tell which was poison ivy. I looked at my school, where even Mrs. Noop, the teacher I once spilled the goldfish bowl on, said she'd miss me. I looked at my special places, where a lot of different things happened. Not just different bad, but different good. Like winning that sack race. Like finding that flashlight. Like spitting farther than Jack 3 times in a row. Like selling so much lemonade that my dad said I would probably have to pay taxes. My dad was just making jokes about paying taxes. I wish he was just making jokes about having to move. I'm not, do you hear me? I mean it. I'm not going to move. Nick says I'm acting like a puke face. Anthony says I'm being immature. My mom says to say a last goodbye to all my special people. I'm saying goodbye, but it won't be my last. I said goodbye to my friends, especially Paul, who is almost like having another brother, except he doesn't say puke face or immature. I said goodbye to my neighbors, especially Swoozy, who is almost like having a dog, except she's the Baldwin's dog instead of mine. I said goodbye to Rachel, who taught me to stand on my head and whistle with 2 fingers, but she says don't try to do both at the same time. I said goodbye to Seymour the Cleaners, who, even if it's gum wrappers or an old tooth, always saves me the stuff that I leave in my pockets. I said a lot of goodbyes to a lot of people and got a lot of hugs and kisses, enough hugs and kisses to last for a person's whole life. I said a lot of goodbyes, except I'm staying right here. I'm not going to move. When the movers come to put my bedroom furniture on their truck, maybe I'll barricade my bedroom door. When my dad wants to tie my bicycle to the roof rack on top of the station wagon, maybe I'll lock up my bike and bury the key. When my mom says finish packing up, it's time for us to get going, maybe she'll look around and she won't see me. I know places to hide where they won't find me. Like behind the racks of clothes at Seymour the Cleaners, like underneath the piano in Eddie's basement, like inside the pickle barrel at Friendly's Market. Or maybe I could hide in the weeds in the lot next to Albert's house, now that I know how to tell which is poison ivy. I'd rather have poison ivy than to move. My dad says it might take a while, but I'll find a new soccer team. He says it might take a while, but I'll find boys my age. He also says that sometimes when a person moves away, his father might need to let him get a dog to be his friend till he makes some people friends. I think that Swoozy, too, would be a good name. My mom says it might take a while, but we'll find a great sitter. She says it might take a while, but we'll find a cleaners who even saves gum wrappers and old teeth. She also says that sometimes when a person moves away, his mother might let him call his best friend long distance. I already know the telephone number by heart. Paul gave me a baseball cap. Rachel gave me a backpack that glows in the dark. Mr. and Mrs. Oberdorfer gave us treats to eat for 1,000 miles. Nick says if I'm lonesome in my new room all by myself, he might let me sleep with him for a while. Anthony says that Nick is being mature. My dad is packing. My mom is packing. My brothers Nick and Anthony are packing. I don't like it, but I'm packing too. They better not try to move anymore when we get where we're moving to. Here's all of them packing. Because this is the last time I'll do it. The next time, they won't make me do it. Never, not ever, no way, N-O. I'm not. Do you hear me? I mean it. I'm not going to move. And that would be our end of Alexander, who's not going to move. I hope you've enjoyed this story today and gotten a little chuckle out of it. Have a great day.
Supper.
Well, I put a roast in the oven this morning, but let it cook too long. It's all burnt and smelly.
Oh, goody. My favorite. Did you make some gooey rice to go with it?
Yes, dear. And some underdone carrots, too.
Mm-hmm. Nobody can cook a meal like you can.
You're so sweet. How's it going raking the leaves?
Oh, I'm gonna quit for the day. The wind came up and almost blew me out of the tree. By the way, I saw Norman on the way over.
He's such a sweet boy. I wonder what he wants.
Beats me. Maybe he forgot where he lives. I wonder who that could be. Why, Norman, what a surprise.
Hello, Mr. Furter.
Come in. Look, Winnie, it's Norman.
Hello, Norman.
Hi, Mrs. Furter.
Well, if you men will excuse me, I have to go make sure that the roast stays crisp.
Well, what brings you to our neighborhood, Norman?
I just live across the street.
Oh, well, how's everything going with you?
Not so good. A lot of bad things have been happening to me.
Oh?
Yeah, I got a flat tire on my moped and don't have enough money right now to get it fixed because I have to pay for a window I broke. And I got a ticket for jaywalking because my hat blew out in the street, and I ran right out in front of a police car to get it. Well, when I finally got home, I found out about half my worms in my worm farm died from some mysterious worm disease.
I see. So you came to borrow a moped tire and a window and some glue to keep your hat on and some worm medicine, right?
Not exactly.
Well, I don't think I can help you with the moped tire. But I'll look around for the rest of the stuff.
No, you don't understand.
I don't?
Frank, you don't understand.
That's what Norman was just telling me. But how did you know?
I couldn't help overhearing. Norman, it sounds like you've had a pretty rough day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I feel like I'll never be happy again.
Of course you'll be happy again. And the best way to do that is to thank God for what has happened.
Huh?
Sure. Remember that God's word says everything that happens to us will turn out for our good if we love him.
Yeah, but...
There's no fighting it, Norman. Winnie's usually right about these things.
Are you sure that'll work?
Well, it always works for us. When it doesn't seem life is going our way, this is what we do. To brighten our day, you can do it too.
Thank God and be joyful. Thank God and be joyful. Thank God and be joyful. Thank God and be joyful.
Now listen, Norm. Into every life some rain it must fall, just to help you grow. Knowing that God's controlling it all helps your heart to glow.
Thank God and be joyful. Thank God and be joyful.
Try it, Norman.
Thank God and be joyful. Thank God and be joyful.
His grace outpoured, His great reward, and all things work together for the ones who love the Lord.
I see now. Nothing's really wrong with shedding a tear. Everyone has cried. Even when pain and sorrow are near, keep the joy inside.
Thank God and be joyful. 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 Thank God and be joyful.
You know, I feel lots better. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome, Norman.
From now on, I'm going to remember to thank God for everything that happens. That way, I'll always be joyful.
Good for you.
Say, Norm, would you like to stay for dinner?
Well, what are you having?
Burnt roast, gooey rice, and underdone carrots.
Mm-mm, my favorites. Boy, nobody can cook a meal like you, Mrs. Furter.
Why, that's just what I say, no?
Yeah, boy, I love that stuff.
Come
know?
On here into the kitchen, son.
Okay.
Oh, well.
Hi, boys and girls. I'm super excited to be here today, and I get to continue the story of Gideon. And 2 weeks ago, Miss Cindy told us that Gideon was inside the wine press threshing his wheat, taking all the wheat that he could eat out of the stalks, because he had to hide from the Midianites. The Midianites were the people who took over Israel and kind of had them held hostage in their own land. And the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon and said, you need to go and rescue Israel from the Midianites. And Gideon tried to make all kinds of excuses. He said, my clan is the weakest clan. It's the smallest clan. There's not enough of us. I'm too young. And he asked for a sign. And the angel of the Lord gave him a miraculous sign. Gideon went and made some bread and some meat and some broth, and he put him on a stone, and then the angel of the Lord just touched it and burnt them all up. So that was like a pretty cool sign, that God was there and God was with them. And then he told, a couple days after that, the angel of the Lord told Gideon to go destroy the altars to Baal, like the fake gods, and replace them with a real altar to the one true and living God, and to sacrifice on it. Now, Gideon was still afraid of the Midianites, and he's afraid of his family because his family worshiped Baal and didn't wasn't true to the one true and living God. And so he snuck around and he did it at night. And, so then it worked. God was with him. And then Gideon blew a trumpet. You know, God told him to blow a trumpet. And he blew a trumpet. And all these people from all over came and, they formed this great big army. So, there's another sign, two more signs that, God is with him. And Gideon is still afraid. He doesn't want to go in this battle. He doesn't trust God enough. He doesn't have enough faith in God that God will follow through and take care of this battle for him. So Gideon tested God again, and this is a story that Miss Cindy told last week. He said, if you really want me to go fight the Midianites, make this fleece that I put down on the ground wet and the ground all around it dry. And God did it. And then the next day, he said, all right, you make the fleece dry and the ground all around it wet. And God did it. So now Gideon is, he's out of time, and he's out of tests to give God, and he's out of excuses not to go fight the Midianites. So the time has come to fight the Midianites. And now remember, I said that they had this big army, right? All these people came, and they had 32,000 people. So, I mean, it was a good size army that God put together for Gideon. So God says to Gideon, all right, it's time to go. Let's go. No more procrastinating. So they start to go out towards where the Midianites were. And God said, wait a minute, hold up. You have too many people. Now, Gideon was afraid to start with, but like now he's feeling better. He's got 32,000 people. It's good. And God says, you know what? I can't let all these people go because you have too many now. And if I turn the Midianites over to you, the Israelites will claim victory for themselves. They'll say, we're going to take credit for it. You know, hey, we put together this 32,000 man army. We went and we met the Midianites and we defeated them. So like, they'll just take credit for it and won't give God any of the credit. So God told Gideon, tell anyone who is there, if you are afraid and you don't want to go in this battle, go ahead and go home. Now, the Midianites had been pretty powerful and they had conquered all the Israelites and they had been there for a long time, kind of taking control over all the Israelites. So, I mean, I might be one of those ones that kind of went home because I might have been pretty scared because the Midianites were pretty powerful. So, God gave them an out. Said, if you're afraid and you don't want to fight, go home. Guess what? 22,000 people went home. So their army went from 32,000 down to 10,000 because 22 went home. So now 10,000 is still a good size army. So they start heading, you know, closer to the Midianites. They go towards a river. Let me just check in my Bible here. Let me see what river it is. And Judges chapter 7, verse 4, the Lord said to Gideon, there are still too many people. Take them down to the water, and I will weed them out for you. Whenever I tell you this one will go with you, he should go with you. But whenever I tell you this one won't go with you, he should not go. So Gideon took the people down to the water. So he's down to 10,000 men. He knows the Midianites probably have more than that. And God says, we're going to go down by the water, and I'm going to tell you, some are going to go with you, and some are not going to go with you. So then the Lord says to Gideon, set aside those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps from those who bend down to drink with their knees. So basically what God is saying, people that go down and they scoop up water and then they lick it out like a dog would lick it out, lap it up like that, they're the people that you need to set aside. Now if people bend down and stick their nose like right in the water, or like get down on their knees and like they're not paying attention to what's going on around them, set them aside. And then God said, the people who went and lapped it up like dogs and were like still kind of able to look around, keep those. Send all the rest home. So Gideon sent all the rest home. Guess how many he kept? Only 300 went and lapped up the water. So 300 stayed. Then the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men who lapped up, I will rescue you and hand over the Midianites to you. Let everyone else go home. So the people gathered their supplies and their trumpets, and Gideon sent all the Israelites home, but kept the 300. Okay, so now we're on to verse 9. The Midianites' camp was below Gideon in the valley. So Gideon was like kind of up on the hill. The Midianites' camp was down below in the valley. And that night, the Lord said to him, get up and attack the camp because I've handed it over to you. But if you're afraid, go down to the camp with your servant and you'll hear what you are saying. So now God knew that Gideon was still afraid. Even though God had showed him all of these great things and reduced his army from 32,000 down to 300, God knew Gideon was still afraid. So then Gideon went down with his servant and he heard the people talking. Just when Gideon arrived, there was a man telling his friend about a dream. He said, get this, I had a dream that a loaf of barley bread was rolling into the Midianite camp and it came to a tent and hit it. And the tent collapsed. In fact, it rolled the tent over upside down so it fell flat. His friend replied, can this be anything other than the sword of the Israelite Gideon, Joash's son? God has handed over Midian and his entire camp to him. So Gideon was still afraid. He went down to the camp to kind of spy it out and to see what the battle was going to be like. And he heard these people talking. And like the one guy had the dream that said, you know, hey, Gideon's going to come with his army and we're going to be destroyed. So that kind of gave Gideon some more courage and some more faith and some more trust in God. When Gideon heard the telling of this dream and its meaning, he worshiped God. Then he returned to the Israelite camp and said to everybody, "Get up! The Lord's handed over the Midianite camp to you." So he's got 300 men. Now he divided those 300 men into three groups. So there's 100 in this group, 100 in this group, and 100 in that group. And he said to each group, "I'm going to give you an empty jar with a torch, like a candle, a flame that would like show light." And he goes, "I'm going to give everybody a trumpet." And he said, 100 men are going to go way over there on that side. 100 men are going to go over here on this side. And 100 men are going to go over here on this side. So they're going to kind of surround the city. And then he said, "When you get to where you need to go, now watch me," he ordered them, "and do what I do. When I get to the outpost of the camp, do just what I do. When I blow the trumpet along with all those who are with me, then you blow your trumpets, all of you surrounding the whole camp, and then shout for the Lord and for Gideon." So he said, "You guys, you 100 go over there, you 100 go over here, you 100 go over there, watch me. And when I start, I'm going to blow my trumpet, and then you guys all start blowing your trumpets, and then shout for the Lord and for Gideon." So they went to the outpost, and when it was like the middle of the night, they had just changed the guards, and then they blew their trumpets, and they smashed the jars that were in their hands. So the three units blew their trumpets and broke their jars. So like Gideon started doing it, and then everybody else started doing it. They blew their trumpets, broke their jars. So like, I think that would make a whole lot of noise and be kind of scary, right? All of a sudden hear all these trumpets, and then hear all this glass breaking. All the way around the camp. So it'd be kind of scary. And then they called out, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." And then here's the really cool part, this battle. None of Gideon's soldiers, none of those 300 men had to fight at all. It says in verse 21, "Each man stood fast in his position around the camp." That means they stood still. They blew their trumpets, they smashed their jars, held the torch, the light up, and just stood there. And then all the Midianites in the camp in the bottom, and the entire camp took off running, shouting and fleeing. They went running away. When the 300 trumpets sounded, the Lord turned the swords of the fellow soldiers against each other throughout the whole camp. So the trumpets started, they broke the glass jars, they held up their torches, the Midianites inside freaked out and started killing each other. So Gideon and his men, those 300, did not have to do anything at all, just stand there. Pretty cool. All right. Then after they were like started killing each other around the whole camp, a few of them started running out, and then like they ran. So the Gideon sent messengers to like these different people, and they started chasing after the Midianites that got away. And Gideon sent some more messengers, and he said, "Go down here and take control." And all the men from the places that Gideon sent messengers to were called out, and they took control of the Jordan River as far as like the Beth Barah. And they captured the Midianite officers, and who were then killed. And they went on chasing the Midianites, and they brought out, until everything was all done on the other side of the Jordan. So this is like pretty cool. And this teaches us a pretty valuable lesson, because for 2 weeks in a row, we heard about how Gideon didn't want to fight this battle. He was afraid because the Midianites were very powerful and strong, and you know, had taken control for a long time. So he asked God for signs, and God didn't let him get out of it. God stayed right there with him, and God gave him the strength and the courage to go into this battle. He even took the great big army and whittled it down to only 300 people. But then God had a plan. He told Gideon to tell the guys, "Blow your trumpet, break your jars, hold your torch up." They did, and they didn't have to move, because it wasn't their battle to fight. It was God's battle to fight. All they had to do was have the faith in God, that God would take care of it. and God would do what he said he would do. So, how I picture that in my life is that God never said life was going to be easy. There's going to be some really hard times. There's going to be some really scary times. There's going to be some really tough times that I have to fight in my life. Same thing with you. We all will have to go through those hard, tough, and scary times. But what I can learn from Gideon is that if I put my trust and my faith into God, God will be there with me and he will help me fight that battle. And if it's not my battle to fight, God will fight it for me. And all I have to do is stand there and trust in God. Now, Gideon didn't have to do nothing. He had to be there and he had to be present and he had to have his trust and his faith in God. So that's what we need to do. We have to be there. We have to be present. We have to build that relationship with God and trust in him that he will be with us through all those hard and difficult times. All right. Have a great week.
There's a verse in the book of Philippians that is a good one for our time, what we're going through. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. It says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." God says, instead of worrying about stuff, give it over to God. If you're anxious, if you're worried, if you're concerned, God says, give it to me. And as you give it to God, God says that he will then give you his peace. So I'm going to see if I can use these ping pong balls to help us see if we can understand this verse a little bit better. This container is going to represent you and I, and the ping pong balls represent the worry about problems. So they're not the problem itself. It's the worry about the problem. Because you may have one problem, but that one problem you find that you get up in the morning, it's on your mind. You're worrying about it. A little bit later in the day, you're worried about it again. A little bit later, you're worried about it again. And the worry begins to build up. And sometimes it seems like you just can't get it out of your mind. And you're worried about it almost constantly, and worry begins to fill up your life. What is the verse? What do those verses say? It says, don't worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known to God. Give the problem over to God. Ask God for his help, for his wisdom to handle it, whatever it is. As you give it over to God, we're going to let the water in this represent God's peace. God says, give your worry over to him. So you give the worry over to him. Okay, we got a little bit of peace in there, but still the worries are overwhelming. You see, when we get to the point when we're worrying on a regular basis, one prayer is not going to be enough. You give it over to God. And when you find yourself worrying again, what do? You give it over to him again. You pray some more. When you find yourself worrying about it again, it might be 2 minutes later. You give it over to God. And as you give it over to God, joy begins to come inside of you. Now notice, the worries are still there, but the joy is coming in. It's beginning to make a difference. You see, when you're worrying about something, really the root thing that's going on is you're not believing God. You're not trusting God that everything that happens to you will work out for your good and for his glory. You're thinking that there's something you can do to help the situation. And so as you're praying, pray about the situation, but ask God to give you the faith to believe that what he's doing is right. To believe that he is giving you the problem or allowing the problem to happen into your life because it will work out for your good. And as you continue to give him those worries to God, what do you see happening? there's more and more joy in your life, and the worry is being pushed out. What will happen is not only will the worry be pushed out, but as you continue to trust in God, He's going to help you to believe Him and to trust Him until instead of worrying about all those things, you're giving them over to Him. Now, look where those worries are. They're on top. They're not down in, and I could try to force one down in, but it won't stay. If I take worries and I begin to throw them, they can't go down in deep. The peace of God will not allow that. You can't have the peace of God and your heart full of worry at the same time. And God says, if you learn to cast your cares upon Him, if you learn to give those worries over to Him and ask Him to help you to believe and to trust Him, God can take the worries away. Now remember, these are the worries. They're not the problem. The problem is still going to be there. I mean, He might even take care of that. But if not, the problem might still be there. But the worries about the problem will no longer overwhelm you. And when you remove the worries from the problem, it helps you to see God much clearer and see that God is big enough to handle the problems and He will work those things out for your good and for His glory. Will you take your worries and anxieties and give them to God and ask Him to help fill you with His peace instead?
Well, here we are at the end of another Tikuma Island online. Right. We're glad you joined us this week.
Yes.
And we hope you enjoyed the big story about Gideon this week.
Yes, he finally got to fight the battle and win it. Like, can you imagine how he must have felt when God said, or he said his army's too small, and God says his army's too big?
Yeah.
And boy, that must have been scary to whittle that down to 300 guys.
Yeah, it must have been, so, but. Anyway, hope you have a great week.
Yes.
And take care, stay safe, stay well.
See you next week.
Bye-bye. Bye.